Hello and welcome back to Continental Club, where we discuss the hottest topics in European football. As you can see, no Mikey McCubbin and Henry Hill today. They're taking a well-earned break. So we've got in some FD royalty for you. It's Zach Jalab. It's Joe Tomlinson. Welcome back to Continental Club, lads.
Thanks,
Zach,
mate.
You were saying it's the first time in a while you've been on this
show. I can't remember the last time I've done Continental Club, to be quite honest. Yeah, it's been a long time. Too long. The fans at home might be saying.
They
won't
be.
But good to be back. Good to talk about European football.
Absolutely. To clarify, we are shooting this on Wednesday rather than Thursday. In Champions League weeks, we will try and film it on a Thursday, so it's super up to date. But tonight, Joe, Man United go to Bayern Munich. I won't ask you to make a prediction because it will be out of date. But nerves?
I'm not nervous because we've got nothing to lose, but I struggle to see us getting a result. I think that's putting it kindly. If United come out of this with any sort of, you know,
dignity,
pride and dignity, then it's probably
what
a win,
score? What is the score where it's like, oh, that's lost? So if you lost 3-0,
I think 3-0, like, most people would be around the prediction of most football fans would say 3-0.
I had a bit of a fighting effort.
As soon as it gets to 4 or 5, then you're in humiliation territory. So that's how low expectations are. But you never know, man. You never know. Bayern Munich, you know, they have looked a bit susceptible at the back this season, but I still think they're going to have way too much firepower for that Man United backline.
Over the last few years, not very good at defending set pieces.
Just as well, because Man United are the worst in the league at scoring them.
That is
true. Yeah, they are.
Not much of a weapon. Get Maguire in. Right.
He's injured.
Oh, he's injured, of course. We can't even. Right. Anyway, let's move on from Man United, because if we went down an injured list, we'd just be here all day. Today, we're talking about the most underrated wonder kids in the world. Now, not the best necessarily, just the most underrated. Trying to give you guys at home a sneak peek into the future. Who wants to go first? Why don't we go with Joe's pick, I think. Joe, who was your most underrated wonder kid pick? Who would you like to start with?
I don't know how underrated you can classify him as, but I feel like comparatively to his teammates, not spoken about nearly enough in wider footballing circles. I've gone for Warren Zaïre-Emery. Because, you know, when everybody has conversations about PSG, it's Mbappe, isn't it? It's the new signings, Ousmane Dembele. It's new signings in midfield, Ugarte at the back. But it's rarely an academy product. And PSG have produced so many wonderful academy products over the years that are no longer playing for the club. You know, you even think of most recently Christopher Nkunku, who's joined Chelsea. You know, would have probably been a bit of a prodigy had he stayed at PSG, but he wasn't. And he was allowed to leave. And Warren Zaïre-Emery feels like one of the first in a while I can remember of truly sort of elite level talents that's been given the opportunity at PSG to make a sustained effort at staying in the first team. Obviously, this is the youngest ever, I think, knockout appearance maker in Champions League history, the youngest ever PSG scorer. He is unbelievable on the ball. And what we're seeing this season from Luis Enrique is much more, you know, sort of targeting on players being good in possession. We know how Luis Enrique wants to play his football. It's massively possession-based. We saw his Spain teams putting up record numbers of World Cup passes. In the past, Barcelona have done the same. PSG at the start of the season, extremely dominant in possession. And largely that is down to Warren Zaïre-Emery's amazing ability on the ball. This is a player who at just, you know, 17 years old is so adept. He can play deep, he can play attacking, he can get in between the lines. Currently, he's kind of featuring on that right-hand side of a midfield three. And he is being supported largely by Ugarte, who, you know, we all know about Ugarte's defensive prowess in that midfield three. But when you pair Vitinha and Zaïre-Emery alongside him, you get this lovely blend of passing. And I just think Warren Zaïre-Emery is really the jewel in the crown. You know, we saw Luis Campos come out this week, didn't we, and say, oh, we didn't sign Bellingham because we've got Zaïre-Emery. Now, how much you believe that remains to be seen, because I don't think Bellingham ever would have picked PSG in the first place. But I do think that they have one of the truly elite midfield talents in Europe. Maybe not on the scale of Bellingham, Pedri, maybe not the profile of Gavi, which is why he kind of fits into the underrated sort of area, Warren Zaïre-Emery, but certainly one of the most elite ball players in Europe. You know, 92% accuracy with his passing this season. I think he's averaging close to 80 passes a game at 17 years old. That is a player who's going out there and dictating tempo. He's been doing that throughout the PSG youth ranks, and I struggle to see a PSG side without him in it. You know, he started every single Ligue 1 game this season for a reason, and I think it will continue that way as long as Luis Enrique is in charge.
Yeah, love it. He had showed a lot of faith in Gavi when he was in charge of Spain as well, Luis Enrique. I mean, I should have said at the top, we'll probably talk about the Champions League games as we go on, all the ones we saw on Tuesday. I mean, Joe, what did you make of PSG against Dortmund? Pretty comfortable, wasn't it?
Pretty comfortable, but I think Dortmund have been pretty underwhelming this season, haven't they, so far? We said as much on Team Talk, I think. I don't expect Dortmund to get out of that group. It's a really, really tough group. But PSG, yeah, I think they looked all right. They looked all right. I think they're going to be tested much more when they go away to St. James's Park in a week's time, is it? Or in 2 weeks'
time? You're backing
them. I think
you're
Newcastle might well get something out of that game, yeah. But I also really liked the interplay on the right-hand side of the midfield three, which largely involves Zaire Emery, when Hakimi, who's playing this much more advanced role this season for PSG, was allowed to kind of float inside. You saw Zaire Emery either drop into almost a right-back role or into this sort of half space that is freed up by Hakimi, and the back three shuffle along because, you know, at times Skriniar does look like he's running with a caravan attached to his back. So he is slow. So they have to have high possession in that right-hand third because of his lack of speed and vulnerability on the counter-attack. So I think Zaire Emery playing as Hakimi cover but also playing as a midfield tempo setter is just perfect in that space. And he looked like, I thought Vitinha was pretty excellent as well, but one of the best midfielders on the pitch, and it's an array of talent across those two teams in midfield.
Absolutely, and Hakimi being freed up as well by Luca Hernandez, new left back as well, yeah. Obviously much more defensively minded than Nuno mentioned years gone by as well. Let's move on to Zach, your suggestion, who's not in Europe this year, but has had a brilliant start to life in the Premier League.
Yes, Pape Sarr. I mean, I think when you looked at Tottenham's squad going into this season, I think a lot of people were actually a little bit worried about their midfield, especially considering the injury that Bentancur had going into this season, Harry Kane leaving, the new system under Ange Postecoglou, pre-season not necessarily going as well as they had hoped, Basuma's previous life at Spurs under Conte not being great. And Pape Sarr coming in as very much a youngster. He's only just turned 21 last week, and got a few minutes here and there last year. I think he got 213 minutes last season under Antonio Conte. This year already, he's got nearly 300. And so Ange has definitely trusted him. I think he's got a manager in Ange Postecoglou that is perfect for him, that when Bentancur comes back, he can still be played the right amount, try to not overload Bentancur, but also try not to give too much too soon to Pape Sarr.
And there is a nice record as well.
Well, this is it. They can play a midfield three with all three of them, including Basuma. Obviously, Hoiberg's there as well. But they're in a nice season where they're not, I think everybody, fans at Spurs and also people watching the Premier League and fans of football, are kind of accepting that this is going to be a year of development for Spurs, where they are going to have players like Adoji, who's another one that could be on this list, to be quite honest, where he's going to settle into this side. Basuma, we've seen Richarlison kind of hopefully given a bit more time and less pressure up top, and so far, actually, things have turned around for him. And Pape Sarr coming into it. I think many Spurs fans didn't quite expect him to have got, or him to have been as much of a success so quickly at Tottenham. He's kind of got everything to his game. He's great defensively. He can pass the ball really well. He's taking, I think, for midfielders, he's in the top 1% for shots per 90 with 2.7. I think there are things he can improve on, but at 21 years old, there are many things that many players can improve on, and that will happen over time. There is a slight thing as well now that we see, because of the likes of Bellingham and Pedri and Gavi and these guys that come through when they're like 16, 17 years old, when someone says 20 years old now, it does feel a little bit like, oh, God, yeah. Like, he is, how's he not already played a full season at Spurs or so on and so forth? I think he played a season for Mets when he went on loan from Spurs back to them. And so you do look at this guy and you think, oh, maybe. But I think that's because you get a little bit confused with the high profiles that are out there. And those guys are like freaks, essentially. That isn't common for it to be happening. But I do think with Postecoglou kind of at the helm for Spurs, he's just going to kind of treat him perfectly. He's not going to overplay him. He's not going to use him in possible games when they need a bit more in Bentancur's ability and put too much pressure on him to thrive. I think he's just got a manager that understands it, it's as simple as like, who kind of just gets it and just understands that sometimes these players aren't stats and numbers. They are humans who do need to be a bit more nurtured and a bit more cared for. And especially when you're this young and going into the likes of this huge stadium that Tottenham are playing in front of every other week, you need a manager who can kind of put an arm around you. It does feel like, from what we've seen so far, and obviously his track history, that Postecoglou is that guy. I think Pape Sarr, I don't know whether we'll sit here and say he'll be one of the best midfielders in the world in 5-6 years. But for a youngster at this age right now, he's doing a lot of good things. And if he continues at this rate, he'll definitely be one of the most interesting to watch grow over the next 5 years.
I think it's like a big testament to him that he's able to keep Oli Skip out the side. Mm. Because Oliver Skip is like, you know, has shown himself over the last sort of year and a bit to be a pretty consistent performer for Tottenham. Even when they were at their worst, really, under Antonio Conte, you could guarantee Skip was going to be giving his all for the badge. He was going to go out there and run his heart out. And yes, his quality level might not be exceptional, but very consistent performer. I think Sarr has just this season like blown him away. Like that midfield three, the balance is just perfection. I think Sarr has a massively high ceiling in the Premier League. Like, I think he could be a real star.
Yeah, absolutely. And we say, well, we're not going to see him in European competition, but it was actually in Europe last year that he really impressed in that last 16 tie Milan. Against Milan. I think it was in the San Siro well. And we saw last night, you know, Newcastle struggling to assert themselves there. You know, Sarr looked excellent.
He's yet to play a full 90, but I think that's a good thing. Like, he's not... That's what I mean by Postecoglou. He's yet to just kind of like be like, okay, play these full games. Like, gets to about an hour mark and he goes, okay, cool, we'll now bring on someone else or whatever it might be. I think he played as a sub in the last game. Obviously, came on and Spurs ended up getting the result they wanted, with him only being on for a few minutes.
He's helped by having Basuma as well, I think.
Massively.
Because Basuma's just like the most press-resistant footballer in Europe right now. You can't get close to him, so people are trying to press Basuma, and I think that is freeing up little pockets a little bit more for Sarr. I don't know how much longer teams are going to attempt to press Basuma.
It'll be interesting to see how Sarr faces against maybe bigger opposition or like a better side. They haven't necessarily played the best sides in the world. Obviously, they did play Manchester United. Looks very good, and United were bad, so we'll be interested to see how he plays against Man City, against Liverpool. Arsenal, obviously, this weekend will be really interesting.
Yeah, I can't wait for this weekend's North London derby. So,
it's going to be big. All right, moving on from a player that's very underrated to one that's potentially not.
How is this underrated, Dukes? Question marks over this chat.
Yeah, I mean, I want to clear top three. Also, it's good for the thumbnail, Xavi Simmons. he has been talked about for years, of course. I mean, signed to the Barcelona youth setup in 2010. By 2017, he was 14, I think, at this stage. And Mino Raiola added him to his stable. 2 years later, he took the decision to go and join PSG. Barely got a look in at PSG, to be honest, but was always, you know, a guy that did the rounds on Twitter being like, look at what this curly-haired youngster he stands out so much on the pitch, not just for how he looks, but how he moves, how he scores, how he assists. He's got the full package, and he looked like someone who was going to take the world by storm when he developed a little bit further. And last year, we saw it on loan at PSV. He was absolutely sensational. He finished as the Eredivisie joint top goal scorer, finished with 22 goals and 12 assists to his name in 48 games in all competitions. And he scored big goals as well. He got 2 assists versus Feyenoord, or was involved in big goals, I should say. 1 goal and assist in the game versus Ajax, and 2 goals on the final day versus Feyenoord as well. PSV now in the Champions League group stages this year, but we thought Xavi Simmons, we were talking about it earlier this summer, he can go and establish himself at PSG. But they actually took the decision to loan him to RB Leipzig. I thought that was the wrong
call. Do you not think that's maybe something he said, right? Where he went to PSG, are you going to play me this year? And maybe they came back and went, well, we're not going to play you in every single game. And he went, okay, if you buy me, I want to go and loan them for the season.
Maybe. I mean, PSV included a buyback clause. PSG obviously went for it. But I think they know that they're sitting on a big money.
Well, United went in for him big, didn't they? Before PSG went back in and activated that release clause, like, United were in really big for him this summer. And then obviously PSG activated. I think it was the right decision to leave PSG again this summer. I don't think he would have got the game time, especially with the arrival of Kolo Muani, that he would have needed this season. I think he wants to operate, you know, in similar areas to either Ousmane Dembele or Mbappe. And I just don't think PSG...
Well, he played off the left, didn't he, last season?
I just don't think PSG have the time to allow him to develop in the... They have to win now, PSG, and they can't afford, when they've already got a Dembele and an Mbappe, Kolo Muani, Gonzalo Ramos as well, to give him the time to develop.
And then and they might be thinking, obviously, Mbappe, it's... I mean, the whole side...
He's leaving
general,
in the summer, isn't he?
This is what I mean. And he's on that left side. Like, maybe that's where he goes back to PSG, or, you know, someone could come in for a big offer for him in the summer.
Well, he's going to leave. Mbappe's going to leave, and he's going to play on the left, isn't he? And it'll be Simmons, and it'll be...
It wouldn't shock me if, come next summer, he goes back to PSG and somebody comes in with a big offer and PSG sell him.
Yeah, I wouldn't
And that's not a bad move either. You make your money back.
Like, you make the point about them having a lot of depth in forward areas, but a lot of those guys came in really late, like Bradley Barcola, I think, was on deadline day. Colomani, I think, was on deadline day as well. You know, there was, I think, a space there for Xavi Simons before they made the decision to spend a lot more money on all these players. And I think he's proven at RB Leipzig that he is good enough for PSG. I think he's good enough for any club in the world, to be totally honest. I mean, he's got played 5 games for them so far at Leipzig, 3 goals and 4 assists.
Some great
all
goals.
All of which have been in his last 3 games. And Leipzig, you know, we were worried for them at the start of the year on Continental Club, talking about the exits of Szoboszlai and Kunku Gvardiol. But Marco Rose's side, you know, they're probably the second best side in the Bundesliga, maybe tied with Bayer Leverkusen. And Simmons has been absolutely crucial so far. He's at 3 shot creating actions per 90. He's scored, he's been very clinical. He's only taken 7 shots and he's scored 3 goals. So that's a little bit unsustainable. But for a guy playing his first senior year of regular football in a top, top league, I think he's been super impressive. But yeah, underrated, maybe not so much. We'll see what he does tonight for Leipzig.
While we're on the topic of Leipzig, I've got another suggestion as well. I think we need to start talking about Benjamin Sesko. I think we are seeing the emergence of like the next, obviously Haaland, you can't really say the next, but like the next big superstar striker in Benjamin Sesko. This guy is
ball striking
crazy amazing. Clinical, like unbelievably clinical. This season, I mean, this month, I think he's averaging a goal involvement every 32 minutes of football he's played. Obviously, he's been having big impacts for his national team, more so now for Leipzig. But he's so physical for a 20-year-old. It is a little bit like watching like a BTEC Haaland. Obviously, you can't compare anyone to Haaland because nobody's going to be able to put up 56 goals or 52 goals in 50 games, whatever it was last season. But like, there's no way Sesko is going to be at Leipzig for very long. He's going to be at Madrid or PSG or Man City or Man United or Chelsea.
Well, I watched him against Chelsea in the Champions League last year when Potter was in charge. Potter's first Champions League game, actually, for Salzburg. And he was the guy that was like, okay, let's have a watch. Let's keep an eye on this guy. And I thought he struggled, if I'm being totally honest. I thought he struggled. But that's not putting a kind of a black mark next to his name or anything. When you're that age and you're playing against the likes of Thiago Silva and these guys, you can struggle in the end. Like he, when I say struggle as well, like he didn't have like the most incredible performance in the world. He also wasn't terrible. And so it's interesting to see him kind of already step up. Like, he saw some of his goals that he scored for RB Leipzig already. Like, he's
the volley is absolutely ridiculous. The fact that United had that £55 million bid or £52 million bid rejected and they sold him to Salzburg for £25 million is just sickening. Sold him to Leipzig, sorry, for £25 million.
Upsetting. Man United missing out again on a top Sesko, young talent.
Definitely.
Yeah, he's worth an inclusion for
Nobody
sure.
Nobody talks about him ever in terms of like the best young strikers either.
Well, it's still
I don't know whether he's had the props of, say, other strikers. Like, Mwani would have got much more praise from him over the last few years up top. Like, Sesko only feels about last year people were mentioning his name. And that wasn't in, like, this... Yeah, exactly.
Younger, yeah.
Much, much younger. I think everyone's almost kind of agreed that it felt like he needed this move to an RB Leipzig for the step up before he makes that next move. Like Højlund, for instance, if we were being brutally honest, felt like we needed to see him have another year at least at Atalanta before getting the purchase. Obviously, United needed a striker, so it makes sense. I feel like Højlund probably got a little bit more prop than Sesko did last year, for sure.
Yeah, fair enough. Right, let's move on to some of these other suggestions. Jacob B. Reedy suggested Takefusa Kubo. Oh. Big fan of this one.
Glad to see he's back.
Yeah. Really big fan. I mean, he moved to Barcelona aged 9 in 2010. He scored 74 goals in 30 games for their junior team in one season. Barcelona then got found guilty of breaking FIFA's rules about signing under 18 talent. So he had to go back to Japan for a couple of years. Then Real Madrid picked him up and he's been on a series of loans.
Mediocre loans.
The only really successful one was when he was about 10 at Mallorca. And then, in recent years, he's also been to Getafe, Villarreal, not really doing much. Then went back to Mallorca, did a little bit better. But then last year at Real Sociedad, he was absolutely immense last year. 9 goals and 4 assists. He's already got 3 goals and 1 assist in 5 games this season. And this is a player who's always been exceptional to watch, but he's now just had that sort of click moment where he's taking shots in dangerous places. He's feeding players in better positions. Like we saw in his performance against Germany in that 4-1 victory over Germany for Japan. Like, he's making the right decisions at the right time. And I'm really, really excited about where this guy can go.
But this is why I think a couple of times we've mentioned it now about the age of these players. Like, when they're having these moments or at 19, 18, where he is only getting, say, one goal and an assist in 28 games, that can happen because it does take time to get used to things, to understand how certain systems work, how it works playing, you know, internationally and so on and so forth. For him now to have kind of had that click moment and looks like the real deal, it's just testament to just kind of not saying if they have a bad year, being like, this guy's done, don't believe in him, which I think a lot of people are quite, which we might even see slightly happening to, say, Jadon Sancho right now at Manchester United, a player who we've seen is very, very good, very, very exciting. He's still very, very, well, not very, very young, but still young enough. Had a couple of bad seasons, not necessarily playing the right system for himself either, not playing even in his best position. And then they could go elsewhere and have a really solid season. Like, I think sometimes football fans are very, very quick to judge a player without giving them necessarily the benefit of the doubt. And it's nice to see that Cooper's come straight back. And, you know, before you know it, could end up at another super club.
Well, who knows? I mean, Liverpool might need a right winger in the next couple of years. Man United might need a right winger in the next couple of years.
Yeah, I think the buyback option is quite interesting as well here, isn't it? Because I think Real Madrid can buy him back for about 30 million euros. But then he has a separate release clause with Sociedad that becomes active, obviously, as every player that plays in La Liga has to do contractually, that any other team buys him, I think Madrid get 27 million euros of it. So, like, Sociedad, unfortunately, they've got an amazing player, but I don't know how much they're actually going to make out of this deal. And it's quite interesting because Sociedad, obviously, in a really good position at the moment, playing really, really well. And, you know, he's such a star player in that side, especially with kind of the dip in form of Oyarzabal, that if they lose him, it's like a big hammer blow. And if they lose him and Madrid take a massive percentage of that sell-on fee, or at least the profit of that sell-on fee, that's a shame for Sociedad, man, because he's obviously a star youngster.
Absolutely. I can't wait to see what he does in this year's Champions League. Russell,
they're going to go well, I think.
They've got a good group.
Surely that's...
I mean, it's even, but they've got a good group.
And that's also, like, they would have known this going into it, right, with that deal. Real Madrid also must still look at him when they sold him and think there's still a player in here that could be beneficial to us later on, to put that kind of buyback and also sell-on clause in his contract. I think it's just... I feel like they would have been aware of this happening. Maybe they wouldn't have expected him to be as quick of a success. But surely, I think if you're doing that kind of contractual,
But they haven't always brought back players that have been exceptional away from them. Like, you think of Martin Odegaard, who probably doesn't have that same buyback clause, but I've not seen any sort of rumours perturbing to Real Madrid being interested in his return. Teo Hernandez was very similar, obviously. Hakimi. Like, they have let players go that have ended up being real stars. That they've just opted not to bring back. And some of those players, obviously, you know, Bellingham was playing 10, so where's the room for Odegaard? You can understand it, but somebody like Hakimi, you know, like Danny Carvajal.
Needed a right back for years.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I don't think it's like necessarily nailed on that Real Madrid will activate, even if Kubo is amazing. Like, I don't think it's necessarily nailed
down there
on.
Brahim Diaz as well has come in as well. Yeah. Zach, let's go to you. We've got a few suggestions down here. Who would you like to talk about next?
Let's talk about Jeremy Doku, who obviously has joined Manchester City.
Who suggested that?
And I've seen...
How's he underrated? How's he underrated?
But he probably was underrated before he played his couple of games for Man City. I think a lot of people wouldn't have had quite a strong idea about what Man City were buying. I think a lot of us even questioned it when it first happened about, he doesn't fit the Pep system. It's just really... He's spent so long now buying these, kind of actually training what he had out of these players. And now we're watching Man City. He's kind of gone, go do your thing. But this is what we've seen Man City do. Every few years, they kind of readapt their system. They get new kind of players into it because other teams are learning how to play against them. And it's nice to see Doku, who is very much a winger, can play either side, want to take on a man, create something out of nothing. And sometimes when you're watching Man City, you can have those moments where you're like, God, I just feel like I've seen this exact same game 10
different
times.
Do you find them boring? Because lots of people say
I don't find them boring, but I do find it very repetitive. Right,
Then
when you add someone like Doku in, you could change that instantly. You can have that little bit of pace to beat a man and go, and he just does. He is your classic kind of archetype of a winger that will beat a man, that can put in a perfect cross, that likes to cut in, as we saw in his goal on the weekend, likes to cut in and can take a very
quick shot.
That goal
as well, the movement of cutting in and then
this
taking
is
the
it.
Shot.
This is it. Considering
like
his age and like... I didn't quite expect him to get as many. I mean, obviously there has been injuries to Man City, so maybe we've seen him play a little bit more than we would have expected straight away.
Fair point.
But he's really, really exciting, man. And like, it just, I think what helps is that because Man City is such a solid base, everywhere is already fixed, everywhere is all pretty good. Whereas a lot of other clubs that you go to, maybe bar Arsenal, have a lot of issues elsewhere. When you can go to a club like Man City, you can just fit in and not worry about being the guy that's got to make sure it works for yourself. You don't have all the pressure on you. You just kind of fit into the system, do what Pep Guardiola tells you, and you normally end up being pretty amazing. And that kind of feels like what Doku's had. He's had this opportunity to join in and just kind of be really free with, like, same with Mateus Nunes, who we saw in the Champions League yesterday.
Looked
like
great.
Looked great. Like, I think that's just one of the that's one of the perks, I guess, of being a Man City.
I thought it was quite interesting, wasn't it, after the West Ham game, that Pep was like talking about him being like a bit scared, and Rodri was saying like a bit scared in his opening games of like getting on the ball, getting 1-1, and then obviously you start to see it against West Ham that when he's 1-1, you're dead basically in that moment. I also love the fact he can play on both wings. Like, it's such a rare trait now for top level wide men, isn't it? Like, you think of the best wingers in world football over the last 5 years, they've traditionally been I'm a right winger, I'm a left winger. You know, think of Mo Salah, for instance, who's obviously been one of the Premier League's greatest ever wingers. You would never see him drift out onto that left hand side. Whereas I think Doku, I'm not saying he's going to get to Salah's level, by the way, here, but I just love the fact he can play on both sides. And I think that versatility at Manchester City is so helpful, especially with the return of Jack Grealish. They'd be able to see him play on the right, and then he can play on the left. Just, yeah, he's just such a scary player, man. For a player that young, he's just...
He does look good. No Bernardo Silva, I should say, for a couple of weeks, yeah. So, looks like he might get a lot more game time as well. It was interesting that he was the guy that actually gave the ball away for the Ward-Prowse goal as well. So, having been shy is the word I think they kept on using in his first couple of games, to then give the ball away and then respond to that goal just after half-term. Half-time. Back at school.
Yeah.
Beautiful stuff from him. Right, Joe, there's a couple more names on this list. Who do you want to talk about?
I mean, Sonetti has suggested Florian Wirtz, which again, I wouldn't describe as underrated, but maybe I'd describe it as underrated by the wider footballing fan who just hasn't potentially heard of him. I don't know how you haven't heard him at this stage, because we are talking about one of the elite talents across Europe, and I think everybody knows that by now. Maybe people are seeing it more now with the emergence of Leverkusen as a legitimate Bundesliga contender under Xabi Alonso. He's certainly kind of showing a level that could win the league, which we haven't seen him be able to show. He's still only 20 and he's got 10 caps for Germany. So, you know, we are talking about a player that very much could be sold for 80, 90 million pounds. And I think his issue is almost, for me, and he's almost been tainted by the Kai Havertz brush. I think a little bit.
So harsh.
I think a little bit. Because he's playing in this sort of 10 spot, this number 10 role at Leverkusen, not many of the other powerhouses in Europe are playing with the traditional 10. Like, Real Madrid, maybe they are a little bit more now. Bellingham's arrived, and Odegaard certainly could say at Arsenal, but I don't see where that role is. Maybe at other European clubs that have the big money, and other teams that have the big money already have the player that fits in that role and that mold. Like, I don't see where he would fit at Man City. I don't see where now Bellingham's gone to Madrid, where he fits there. Like, I don't see where he fits at Liverpool. I don't see where he fits at PSG. Like, he just doesn't.
It's good for Leverkusen, though.
He doesn't quite fit with the European mold of elite clubs right now, which is like why I'm not saying he's Kai Havertz 2.0, but I think that's probably what happened to Kai Havertz, where he went to Chelsea, where it didn't quite fit. As a 10, then he was a 9. He was like, why didn't quite work
there? He was more of a second striker when he came.
Yeah, but we've seen Florian Wirtz play as a second striker as well at times. I'm not massively convinced where he fits at a certain club. I think the club has to be perfect for Florian Wirtz, and that role has to be perfect, because he is quite a specific footballer. You couldn't just stick him out on the left wing.
No, probably not. It'd be a waste of his talent as well. I mean, his vision, his timing, it's all spot on. The club that I said he should go to a few years ago, which doesn't really fit him so much anymore, I actually think he's the perfect De Bruyne replacement. But actually, looking at him now, he's almost too similar to Phil Foden. Like, there is a lot of overlap. Left-footed, small in stature, like, really good on the half turn, great vision. I think he would have been a good fit as a Modric replacement, but Real Madrid are going for these more physical players in midfield as well.
Everybody's going for the more physical players. Yeah. Look at Arsenal starting 11. They are massive. The midfield is massive. Real Madrid, massive. Like, Man City are huge. And that is, like, clearly a developing trend across Europe that teams are going for more physicality, especially in midfield.
But it's good news for Leverkusen. Hopefully they get to keep hold of him for a little bit longer, especially because he's only just come back from an ACL
injury.
Amazing,
you know,
and just returned to his top level. I think
his touch is so ridiculous.
It's brilliant. Right, final one to mention, Lamine Yamal. This comes in from Mostafali Razvan, only 16 years old. He's only just 16 as well. He turned 16 in July, and he'd only played 7 minutes prior to this season. He's only played 260 minutes this season. He's only got one assist, is what I meant to say. Saturday, which was against Villarreal. He then got called up to the Spanish squad as well, scored on his debut against Georgia. But it feels like he should have more goals and assists. He has actually changed most games he's been involved in for Barcelona on the right-hand side. Rafinha has been injured, so they needed him. They needed him at various points. Before João Félix's arrival, you know, they were looking a little bit short in forward areas. Félix has really hit the ground running there as well. He's been absolutely superb. But Lamine Yamal, only Lewandowski has taken more shots than him in the Barcelona squad. He's completed 7 dribbles already at a 64% completion rate. He looks like he's got it all. He looks like he's got it all. And it's ridiculous to say about a 16-year-old. I don't want to hype him up too much. But there is a certain Saka-esque to the way he plays. He's got a wonderful left foot. He's got wonderful delivery. Potentially more of a creator at the moment than a goal scorer. But this guy looks like he's going to be absolutely ridiculous. He's been one of Barcelona's best players at 16 years old in a Barcelona side that have just won the league title. I think it's really, really impressive. So definitely one to keep an eye on. Final one to mention, Julio Enciso. He's injured at the moment. Feels like a bit harsh to put him amongst this reckoning. But guys, let us know about your wonder kids. Who do you think is the most underrated? Actually, before we move on, guys, you got to pick your two most underrated and we need a ranking of them.
From this list.
Sesco.
Sesco, is he number one for you?
And Zaire Emery. I'm picking my own two.
Picking your own two. Okay.
I'll throw Sar in there.
Sticking by Sar.
And I will go...
Underrated is a bit different.
This is what I mean. Doku's not underrated now. He's moved to City. Verts isn't underrated, for being honest. Kubo started getting his props.
You can say Sesco, mate.
No, I'd go with Yamal.
Nice. I'm going to go with, again, I think I get Xavi Simmons.
Maybe
Emery
as well, to be fair.
I'm going to go with Kubo and Florian Verts, because I still think he is underrated amongst, you know, the wider European football circles, because I do think he is pretty, pretty special. Guys, who are your most underrated wonder kids? We missed loads out, by the way. The tweet had about 3,000 replies. Get yours in the comments and let's move on to big match predictions. Okay, it's time for big match predictions. Now, obviously, our predictions this week don't count to the overall leaderboard, but we'll bring you up to speed with what happened last week, because it was pretty entertaining. Bayern Munich versus Bayer Leverkusen. Henry went 2-1 to Bayern. Both McCubs and I backed the Desmond, the 2-2. 3 points to each of us. Perfect score.
Very good. Unlucky for Henners, that as well.
Very unlucky. Very unlucky, because it was only in the final few minutes. Yeah. Inter versus Milan. I went for a draw. Those two backed Inter, not those two, the other two. But no one saw the 5-1 coming,
Jesus
of course.
Christ.
So 1 point to Henry and McCubs. Real Madrid versus Real Sociedad. Henry went 0-0. Don't know what was up with him. McCubs went 1-0. I went 3-1. It was 2-1. So 1 point to McCubs and 1 point to myself. So the scoreboard, which doesn't count for this week, obviously. McCubb in, coming back from a horrendous year last year, is on 13. I'm on 10. And Henry, to do on 6. This week, though, first game we're going to talk about is Gladbach versus Leipzig, Saturday, 2:30 p.m. 14th versus 3rd. 7 points between them at the moment. Joe, you've been taking a look at this game. What are your thoughts?
My thoughts are that Leipzig are going to win.
Yeah.
My thoughts are that Leipzig are going to win. I do think they... I know that Leverkusen are obviously flying, but I think Leipzig might be the second best team in the Bundesliga, to be honest with you. I know they beat them on the opening day, didn't they? But since then, like, they're really starting to click. And I just think Marco Rosa is one of Europe's best coaches as well. I think with Sesco coming into form, obviously we've spoken about Xavi Simmons, but also Dani Olmo as well in recent weeks. You know, they're putting up goals, man. 5-1 against Stuttgart, 3-0 against Union Berlin away from home. Nobody goes to Union Berlin and wins games. It's one of the hardest places in Europe to go and win games, as I'm sure we're going to find out in the Champions League. Great result there. 3-0 against Augsburg, 3-1 last night against Young Boys as well in the Champions League. And Gladbach, they've been crap at home. Like, they've been really, really bad at home. They got that 3-3 draw away at Darmstadt, but then 1-0 loss at home against Werder Bremen, 3-0 loss against Leverkusen at home, 2-1 loss against Bayern Munich at home. They can't beat the big boys at home. And Leipzig can't stop scoring goals. I think Leipzig win this 2-1 or 3-1 away from home.
Ooh. Zachary, do you see more goals, less goals?
I see, you said 3-1, yeah?
Yeah.
I will go 4-1 to Leipzig.
4-1, fair enough. I mean, I really like Gerardo Seoane, the Gladbach coach, but it hasn't been a brilliant start. I mean, it was going to be difficult for them, losing to Ram, losing Lars Stindl, losing Bence Baini, not
squad
getting fees
so
for any of them. Yeah, it's not great. Difficult to go with anything other than a Leipzig win. I'll go 2-0. I'll go 2-0 to Leipzig. Right, let's move on to Le Classique. Sunday, 7:45 p.m. PSG versus Marseille. Neither in great shape in the league.
Well, one...
Fifth versus third.
One probably a little bit worse than the others with recent events. Obviously, Marseille have sacked Marcelino, or Marcinho's left Marseille.
The second walker.
Everything that's happened. It's such a tough atmosphere, that Marseille. Like, I can say from personal experience of going there, it's one of the, it's probably the best atmospheres I've ever been to. But goodness gracious, I would not want to get on the the bad side of any of those fans. I think you're right. PSG at the moment are kind of started. No, they've started slowly, but I think that Dortmund win now might help them kind of get to gear and push up to the next gear. Obviously, they do need to as well. They need to start acting pretty soon if they want to make sure they can lead the race for Ligue 1 to win the title again this season, because they are slightly slipping behind now with how things are going in the league. I think if we're being brutally honest,
PSG have got to win this, man. PSG,
no, they've got to win this, but will they? That's the issue. Like, it's at home at the Parc des Princes, which makes sense. I think with the stuff that's happened around Marseille recently, I think that could take a lot of headlines and because of that make it a little bit tougher for them to go away to the Parc des Princes, up kind of the opposite end of the country. Mm. And such a big, obviously, such a classic fixture too. I think it's probably leaning towards a PSG win. Let's go with a 2-1 win for PSG. But it could be a draw. It could be a draw.
I mean, everyone thinks that PSG have had a big game in midweek against Dortmund, but Marseille are playing Ajax on Thursday with even less time to recover for this, without a manager and with everything sort of in disarray after a... Well, results actually haven't been too bad. That's kind of the weird thing.
And they lost a few players that were there last season in terms of, obviously... he's the boy that's just joined Nottingham Forest. Nuno Tavares was their left wing back. And he, it felt like when you watched them, honestly, it felt like everything good and everything bad went through him. Down that left flank.
Gendouzi as well.
Gendouzi left. Gendouzi. Alexis Sanchez went.
Did Payet leave in the end?
Payet retired.
They did bring in the likes of Aubameyang. So, like, who we thought would score. I thought he'd score goals in Ligue 1, man. Lacazette went there and pumped 25 in last season.
That was weird.
and now look at
the scoreline, Joe. What do you think?
I think there's big pressure on PSG in this game. You know, this is the worst start in the history of the club under the Qatari era. I don't think Luis Enrique can lose this
game. They wouldn't be sacking Luis Enrique.
I'm not saying he's going to be
sacked,
but I think if he loses Le Classic at home, they start the season with 3 losses in the first 6 games. I'm not saying he's going to be sacked, but I think pressure will be turned up. Like, I think they'll win anyway, because I think Marseille Europa League is going to tire them out. So I think they'll win 2-0 or 3-0. But if it's some shocking loss and they lose 2-0, I think people will be like, what is going on here? Because Enrique's stock took a bit of a melting, I thought, of the World Cup as well.
Joe hates PSG.
I do. Yeah. I do.
Doesn't even try to hide it. Yeah. Zach, did you say a
score? I said 2-1 PSG.
You said 2-1. Yeah, I can't go in anything other. I might go 4-0 PSG. Ooh. Absolutely rip them apart. Right, final game. Atletico Madrid, Real Madrid. Huge game. Sunday, 8 p.m.
Goals, goals,
seventh
goals.
Versus first. There's already 8 points between them. Atletico Madrid did have that game against Sevilla postponed, so it has slightly skewed the table somewhat. So 7 points from a possible 12 isn't a total disaster. But last weekend, got battered by Valencia. Really, really bad performance. They were all over the place at the back. Struggled to make the most of their opportunities against Lazio on Tuesday night as well, before Provedel scored that amazing goal from it wasn't even a corner, it was just a great ball in as well, you know, cutting through there in his bright yellow kit and then not having a clue how to celebrate. It was one of the moments of the round. I loved it. But yeah, quite a few injury issues for Atletico Madrid as well. They've got Lamar's out for a while now, Depaul, Soyuncu, Depay, Koke and Ronaldo, and they've only won 1 of their last 14 games against Real Madrid. And that dates back to October 2015. There have been 6 defeats in that time, only 6 defeats. So most of them have been draws, but still, that's not a great record. Real Madrid, meanwhile, they keep on charging on in the league. I don't really know how they're doing it, but they are.
They haven't been amazing, have they? Like, yeah,
it's partly the fact. And Hossolu as well scored a good goal at the weekend as well.
Did you see the comments of Ancelotti about Hossolu? Just like ultimate praise. He was like, if we had Hossolu over the last few years, we would not have any of the issues we'd had.
Really?
Yeah, he was loving him.
Love that. But yeah, as we mentioned earlier, Real Madrid are going to Union Berlin tonight, whereas Atleti came back from Rome a day earlier against Lazio. I think this is going to be quite tight, actually. I actually might go for a draw. I don't think that's a disaster for Real Madrid. I might go 1-1. Zach?
I just think... I was thinking a draw, and then he was looking at that injury list they've got now. They were...
Morata against his former club. It's written.
It's also happened several other times.
Every game against one of his former
guys. Literally. I'll go with, you know, just be a little bit different because I was thinking a draw. I say a little bit different. I was going to pick a Real Madrid win. A 2-0 Real Madrid win.
Mate, you went crazy there.
I know, so sorry.
Yeah, wild. Bellingham's get him over the line. Another goal from the big man. Header from the corner. 1-0, 90th minute, Bellingham. One of them at the Wonder.
They'll build a statue if that happens. Seriously, on the basis of his first 6 weeks. It's been absolutely remarkable. Guys, that is our score predictions for these three games. Get yours in the comments down below. Thank you so much for watching Continental Club for another week. If you enjoyed it, go check out yesterday's team talk. It was actually a spicy one. Everyone was very, very fired up. So go and check that out. Get prepared for Sunday vibes on Sunday. Follow, you know, us all on Twitter and Instagram, whatever. And we'll catch you later in the week. Bye-bye.